iHeartRadio station.
Hey, what's happening?
Brother, what's up?
This is a big party, man.
Yeah, brother, like, solid. Right on.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kisser.
I seem to be inept at everything except my work. I'm good at my work. So I confine myself to that. All I want out of life is a 30 share and a 20 rating.
The man's enlarged my mind. He's a poet, warrior in the classic sense. I'm a little man. I'm a little man. He's a great man.
Think of it as colors. There's black and there's white. And in between is mostly gray. That's us. Now, gray is a tough color because it's not as simple as black and white. And for the media, certainly not as interesting. But it's who we are.
Leader Fan, Fan Radio Network.
Tweet that.
And KFAN.com. 2 minutes. No, 1 minute, 58 seconds past 3 o'clock. Central Standard Time. Welcome back, Friday edition, to wrap up a very big week on the Bumper to Bumper show here on a rather overcast Friday afternoon here in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. I am the host of the program. My name is Dan. Is about to get on a bird. For, I think, Lincoln, Nebraska, go for women's basketball tomorrow, and then go for men's basketball at Nebraska on Sunday, if I'm not mistaken. So Brett Blakemore, a Sunday regular, is in that chair, and he will stay in that chair between now and 6:30 this very evening. We're delighted that many of you, I hope all of you, are around for the entire ride today. We'll take, though, whatever we can get from you. We will remind you that there have been some changes to the usual sequence of guests on Friday. Bort and Volvo guest lineup will include Ben Goessling at the bottom of this hour rather than 4:30. He will join at 3:30. Latest Kirk Cousins rumors will be run by him. Perhaps he will even introduce a couple of them to us and tell us whether we should take them seriously. And he will file a live report about his return to the barn. He was at Williams Arena last night to see the Golden Gopher Men's Club knock off the Ohio State Buckeyes 88-79. I thought Ohio State is not a very good team. They did beat Purdue last time out. They fired their coach. They're 5-11 now in the Big Ten, but still a good performance by the Gophers, who really have to pretty much win all their home games and probably steal a couple of road games if they're going to get serious about literally getting into the NCAA tournament or have a decent chance to do it. We'll get into that with him and Viking stuff and who knows what else at 3:30. He has moved from his usual 4:30 slot because we expect at about the bottom of the 4 o'clock hour, Sam Mitchell will join us. Sam's in town along with, I think, Pooh Richardson. They're doing a bunch of Wolves stuff. And of course, the Wolves are back in action at Target Center tonight against the Bucks, a game you can hear on the Timberwolves channel, iHeartRadio app. Wild on the Fan, FM 100.3 against Edmonton. Is it 9 o'clock opening faceoff? I think that's what it is. I would assume
8.
Oh, it's 8?
Yes.
Oh, my apologies.
So yeah, extended pregame starting at 7.
Okay, there you go.
Going up to 8.
There you go. So both of our winter sports teams in action. Both very much wanting victories for reasons that I think should be obvious in the case of the Wild. For the Wolves, in part, it's the old national TV bit. It's a late game here by our normal standards because we are the second game of an ESPN doubleheader. And that's why there will be a late start. I have determined I'm going to go. I don't know if I'll regret it because that's really late for me. I worry about teeth in the glass, the whole bit. I hope I don't nod off at halftime. That would be embarrassing in front of the crowd. But I'm going to give it my best shot tonight as well. Lavelle on everything is scheduled for 5:30 this evening. So nice lineup. Goessling, Sam Mitchell get a nice national perspective with still a lot of local sensibilities because of all the time Sam spent here on the Wolves and the NBA. And then Lavelle will kind of cover baseball, football, basketball. We'll give him another opportunity to apologize on behalf of the Twins for one of the poll ads, I think it's Joe, had to say that we spent a lot of time on yesterday as well. Bradshaw and Brian, KFAN text line is open at 646-86. Some of you already checking in. I mentioned the dawning of the age of Aquarius. I may be jumping the gun, but it did strike me that a quote I read, I saw, or heard and then read, that caught my eye. It doesn't sound like much. In fact, for many organizations, comments like this about an organization would probably be met with a yawn or two. But I'm trying to remember or think about how many times in the history of the Minnesota Timberwolves, and I've been here since the beginning, since before the beginning, how many times a player has publicly proclaimed this organization is headed in the right direction. And by the way, it's a player, in this case, who's been around for 17 years. He's an NBA veteran. He's seen highs. He's seen lows, but he's seen a lot of really good, and he's played for a lot of good organizations. He knows, I think, what that looks like. And upon confirming that he is signing a 2-year contract extension with the Timberwolves, Mike Conley said, and I quote, "This organization is headed in the right direction." Again, it's not what you'd call breathtaking headline news in most cases, but here it kind of is. Now, is it a huge move? No. Is it an important move given what Conley means to the organization? Yes. And it's a move, frankly, he doesn't really have to make because the money he got was okay. I think he got $11 million a year. I guess technically the extension, it's not even 11 a year. It's worth $20.75 million overall to remain with the Timberwolves. And in this organization's history, we've rarely heard these words. Largely because I'm not sure how many times any player, if they're being honest about it, believed it. Now, they may have lied a few times, and you can say, well, maybe he's just saying what he has to say, but he doesn't really have to say it. He doesn't really have to do it. And it does tell you. It doesn't win a playoff game, doesn't win a playoff series. But what it does, I guess, confirm to me is you've got some stability here. You've got continuity here. And you've got a veteran player saying, yeah, I'll finish here if I can. I'll finish my career here. How many times, maybe not always publicly, but how many times was I made aware? This is especially back in my ink-stained wretch days when I was around the team a lot more. That players who were here couldn't wait to get out of here. Couldn't wait to get out of Dodge. And if they were going to commit longer term here, it was simply because they got over, you know, the team was willing to overpay them to stay, to beg them to stay. This is the kind of medium-sized move that good, stable organizations make as a matter of course. But it never hurts when a smart, veteran, adult, yeah, past his prime, but still effective basketball player sends out signals that other players around the league, because other players around the league know about Mike Conley and know what kind of player he is, what kind of leader he is capable of being. And they say, huh, that's interesting. I can still remember, God, there's so many. And by the way, you don't win a playoff game or series this way. There's no banner that goes up. That still has to be done. But you can argue that this is, what was the Jerry Kill term, brick by brick? This is one of those bricks that you put into the wall and cement that can be part of a larger effort to make people believe that something positive could be happening here. Obviously, the president of basketball operations isn't going anywhere. No reason to think the head coach is going anywhere. Now, we could be talking different if they get to the first round as a number one seed and get swept in round one. But I dare say, even if something that calamitous happened, I don't believe there'd be any significant changes in terms of the coaching and who's running the team. I think there would still be a belief, as Conley has, that this team can be relevant for a while and can take several swings at, yeah, dare I say it, even perhaps winning a championship or at least making some significant runs. It's solid when a solid guy like Mike Conley sends out this kind of message. It's revolutionary here. It's no big deal a lot of other places. But you got to remember some of the things that have happened here. You got to remember the night a head coach named Bill Blair, fresh off another Wolves loss, finishes his post-game scrum with the reporters, is walking back towards the locker room, and runs smack dab into one of his players, Isaiah Jr. J.R.J. Ryder, who is demanding an audience with those same reporters because he's been told how heavily the head coach has criticized him. This is the team that had a player named Christian Laettner, who in a locker room one day pointed to the locker names of several other players and said, loser, 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 loser. The list of calamitous, unstable activity, the number of changes, front office, head coach, etc., endless. So this nice little modest move, don't underrate it about what it tells you regarding the current position of this particular program. Let's get our first break in. We'll get to some texts. I've got some college basketball I do want to discuss, and I want to get to two important back-to-back games, Wild related as well, with Mr. Hockey himself.
Channel the Fan.
Head over our contest page, register for your shot at a pair of early screening passes for Dune Part 2 in theaters March 1st. KFAN.com, keyword contest, enter today.
By the way, we will discuss the not all that surprising announcement regarding a huge salary cap increase in the National Football League. There are a lot of people who want to believe this is going to make it easy for the Vikings to sign everybody and a couple of other players that we don't know of. I don't know if it's quite that simple, but the cap number went up, was it $30 million? Is that correct? I think it was about 30.
Yes, it
from
was
year to year.
I want to say I have it written down for five.
I think it's now $255 million. I'm not.
Yeah, it was the largest jump it's taken since 1994. Yeah.
So my guess is they kind of knew, but maybe they didn't know it was going to be quite this big. A couple things I want to get to here, including some texts that have come in early to the broadcast before we prepare for Ben Goessling at the bottom of the hour, because he can give us much more depth regarding the salary cap news. Trail Ref Guy, I think, is insulted by my Christian Laettner anecdote I passed along. He says, or he writes, that was Christian Laettner, four-time Final Four appearance guy, two-time back-to-back national champion. Yes, they were losers, the greatest college player of all time. The point of that story wasn't to impugn the integrity of Christian Laettner, although I must point out, Christian Laettner at that point was nowhere near as good as he thought he was. He sometimes acted as if he were still at Duke, and he wasn't. In fact, Laettner ended up being nowhere near the pro player that I predicted he would be. I thought he'd be an excellent pro player. In fact, I thought he'd be as good in his own way as Alonzo Mourning. I couldn't have been more wrong, as it turns out. The point of the story was dysfunction. The amount of dysfunction that has taken place over the decades involving the Minnesota Timberwolves. And that was another example of it. Regardless of what you think of, well, Laettner had every right to say what he said. If you agreed with Laettner, that's not a good sign for what you got going in the organization. If you don't, you think Laettner might want to get over himself just a little bit. There's just so many mythic lore stories that seem now to be foreign. But part of that is, part of the reason I think a lot of that stuff happened, again, was there was no continuity. There was very little stability. There was, in the Flip McHale years, for a while, and then even that got a little bit pear-shaped. And I think the kind of stability you have now is what fosters a belief in a veteran player who could finish his career anywhere, that says to him, yeah, I'm fine with this. No matter what he thought when he came, I've seen enough. I kind of like the landscape as well. Here's some snark. I hear A-Rod thinks the organization is also headed in the right direction. It's heading in the direction west to Seattle. Wow. Well, we'll get to that. That's an arena cheap shot. A 320 guy writes, I realize this individual was never an NBA player, but I believe David the Meerkat Khan has once stated that the organization was heading in the right direction after drafting Johnny Flynn. That's true. It's been uttered a few times. Let's just say it doesn't sound quite as hollow now as it once did. Quickly, because we're going to get to this with Goessling as well. I mentioned the Gopher Club last night, knocking off Ohio State 88-79. It was a good victory against a not very good team, but yet a team that had just knocked off Purdue. So they had shown a little bit of chops. They've got some ability, but they're a mess. They fired their coach, etc. What I liked again about last night was especially what I saw from Elijah Hawkins. This was a career best night for him, as the Star Tribune points out. But this is one of those transfers that came from a place that made you wonder whether he could really be a factor at the Big Ten level. And the more I've seen him, the more we've seen of him, the more dynamic he's looked, the more comfortable he's looked, and the more important he has looked to what they're doing. They were awful last season in no small part because they had terrible perimeter play. He has been among the perimeter players who has changed a lot of that this season. He's got really good quickness, can dribble anywhere, can get from point A to point B very effectively. And the more you see of him, the more you say, nice little guard. Now, as guards, you know, I've talked about for a while, the rub is going to be, are there going to be some more advanced schools further along that identify him and say, Elijah, I know you like winning because you won more than you did a year ago, but do you want to make sure you're in the NCAA tournament? Do you want to maybe even think about going somewhere in the tournament, we got a deal for you. That's going to be, it's the ironic. The better the Gophers play, the bigger the challenge might be for Ben Johnson to keep everybody. Now, on the other hand, you could say, well, no, if they're doing well, they should be, there should be no discouraging word. They should then want to say, let's go to the next level here. But that's not the world we live in anymore, man. Because we never know what's going on behind the scenes. Small slights that aren't even real slights that a player might perceive. And then he says, I'm going someplace else. That's the X factor. As odd as it sounds, the better the Gophers have been this year, I think the greater the challenge might be of keeping this whole group together. And if Johnson does, and I think you have a chance to think next year could even be better than this year as well. Do we have to win? Do we have to, as in we, the Wild, do we have to split the next two? Will you take... Or do you think, are you demanding the victories? These are both two good opponents, correct?
Yes.
That it doesn't matter what's fair. What's fair is the position you're, the reality of your position is you're going to have to steal games like this. You can't just be moral victories at this point. What are you willing to accept over our next two games?
I mean, there are 4 points down.
After last night, right? Everybody
won.
Won yesterday, yeah.
Yeah, so, and by the way, not only are they 4 points down, but there's 1, 2, 3 more teams ahead of them in between the Blues and the Wild. There's a lot of teams fighting for this, but it's not like they're just chasing down the Blues.
Right.
You're coming to crunch time. We've been saying it's been in crunch time and must win for what feels like weeks now. It really matters now, and they need to step on it. They can't have performances like they did in Winnipeg, where they just get outclassed for the majority. They did outshoot for a while, but it just feels like there's a split between the top of the Central and the top of the West and everybody else. And Edmonton, right now, the Wild are everybody else.
So it's Edmonton tonight, Seattle. Is it back-to-back, or we got a night in between?
Yeah, Seattle tomorrow.
Seattle tomorrow. Okay. Do you view Edmonton as a legitimate Stanley Cup candidate?
That's the million-dollar question, because they have the goal scoring
right
for it. And they have the firepower, which is what, something I value greatly. They've been to a Western Conference Finals in their recent history, so they have more playoff success than the Wild do, playing a more attacking and aggressive style. It's always been, in my opinion, the goaltending that's held them back. So I'm not a betting man. If I was, right, I'd say they'd win a round or two at least, but they usually find a way to blow it towards the end of it.
Let's get to some meat and potatoes, Kirk Cousins speculation, salary cap increase speculation, all of that, and a little bit of Gopher talk with Ben Goessling, a Gopher himself. He was at the barn last night, I think, for the first time in a while. Maybe he, like a lot of people, are starting to feel it's safe to actually return to Williams Arena. Goessling, questions for him, hit the text line, 646-86, Bradshaw.
KFAN, the Fan.
The 2024 TIAA Big Ten Women's and Men's Basketball Tournaments are headed to Target Center March 6th through the 17th, and tickets are going fast. For more info and to purchase tickets, KFAN.com, keyword calendar.
Questions for Goessling? Let me know via the Bradshaw and Brian KFAN text line, 646-86. Sam Mitchell in town, where some Timberwolves work, will join us about 4:30 this evening. Wolves late game tonight against the Bucks as they start the second half at 9 o'clock. Goessling joined us via the Connecticut Water Systems hotline. My sources say you returned to the barn yesterday. I don't know how long it's been. Did you come away from the experience now concluding it is safe once again to go watch Gopher men's basketball at the barn?
Yeah, it was fun. I think it was my first time in there in, I've been since I was a student. Wow. There's like maybe one or two games that I'm forgetting in there, but it's been a long time since I've been in the barn. So yeah, I had some friends last night to the game, and the get me in price was like $15. So like, yeah, what the heck? Let's go see it. And they're getting hot and have an outside chance to get into the tournament. So yeah, it was a lot of fun. And you know, the crowd was not what I remember from the old days of when I was a kid and it was impossible to get in there, but there was some energy, and student section was good, and yeah, it was a lot of fun. So it's a team that seems to be building some momentum. Obviously, they've got some things going right with Hawkins and Garcia and Payne, and it was fun to be back in there and fun to see some energy start to build in that place again.
Well, it now looks like they may have some intriguing pieces. They got to keep them together, and they got to keep building on it. But it's part of the as odd as this sounds, what Ben had going for him was it was so bad last year that anything was going to look like, because I'm already hearing comments about, contract extension and coach of the year. And look, maybe I haven't done a long, hard search in the Big Ten when it comes to coach of the year, but part of why it looks so good is just how I think they won two Big Ten games last year, which is hard to do. And so some of it is that. But I fully agree. I thought it was a good victory against not a great team, but a victory that still felt authoritative. I felt like even the Purdue game, where they blew the big halftime lead, I still accepted it as a moral victory, because once Purdue kind of took over, they didn't stop playing, and it didn't turn into, okay, Purdue by 12. It was actually a reasonably tight game until the final minute. So you're seeing some stuff from Ben. You're seeing some stuff from some individual players, maybe starting with Hawkins, who, as we talked about, they had a lot of transfers, but from schools where you got, well, I don't know. I mean, how's this going to apply to the Big Ten? But the more Hawkins plays, I think the more legitimate he looks at this level.
Yeah, and the thing is, he was not afraid to get his own shot.
Yep.
I mean, he got hot, especially in the second half from three-point, but it's, if you have a guard like that, that you trust with the ball, that distributes it well, which that's been what he's done. But then if he's able to get hot and get some points of his own, which he was able to do last night, if they get in, that's one of those things that you need to be able to stay afloat in the tournament. And I'm not talking Cinderella, right, anything like that at this point. It's hard to say that, but the ability to have a guard that you trust that can run the offense and bring the ball up, I think, is a big deal. And it's been a long time since they've had a guy that looked that in command as he did last night.
24 points, 7 assists. I think it was a career, at least a season high for Hawkins on points, 24, to go with the 7 assists as well. All right, Vikings fans are trying to figure out how to process the news breaking today about an extra $30 million added to the cap. They want to believe that it's going to make it easier for the Vikings to have all kinds of flexibility to bring everybody back, everybody back that they want to. Is it that simple, or what did you make of it?
Well, I think it's a two-sided coin in some ways. Yes, it makes it easier. I think they haven't been in this good of a cap situation in a long time, and that's due to the fact that the cap has gone up. It's also due to the fact that did not kick the can down the road on some of the moves they made last year, like Adam Thielen, Eric Kendricks, some of these where you could have said, well, we're going to push some of the cap money into the future. They said, no, we're going to rip the Band-Aid now, especially with Thielen, take a lot of dead money last year in order to have a better financial picture in 2024. So it does make it easier to afford things. It also means that everybody else has more money too. And I think the times that we've seen this, I can remember one of the years.
Yeah, I think we need to bail, unfortunately, Brett Blakemore. We're going to jump in. Or usually the technology we use with Ben is very effective. He knows what he's doing with it. But today, for whatever reason, it's not cooperating. So we might just go back to the old-fashioned phone system. Some good texts are already coming in. Keep them coming. Lavelle will join at 5:30. We'll get that'll be his opportunity to apologize for the Minnesota Twins about the payroll one more time. Or maybe he'll surprise us and he won't. He kind of surprised us the other day, so maybe he won't. Let's try Ben again. Yeah, the signal was just getting kind of funky. So you were discussing how you view this salary cap increase as a double-edged sword, a two-sided coin.
Yeah, I think it does give them more room to play with. It also makes it so that everybody else can possibly drive prices up when people have more money to spend. I think, you know, you've seen this in the past, and probably not as much in the NFL, but it certainly, I remember some of these years in the NBA where the new TV money hits and it just drives prices on everything up. It will be interesting to see how this shakes out in the overall free agent market in the NFL. It has been a little more tepid for veterans in the last few years, and I think teams have kind of gone with the, well, we're going to have younger players in here, and maybe that's just been to stay afloat. And there's been kind of a, I think, a general cautiousness in free agency that a lot of teams have used over the last few years, and we'll see if all of this money starts to change that. But I do think they're in a better financial situation than they were, and a lot of that has been because they put themselves in a better spot with their cap picture, not kind of kicking money down the road from Adam Thielen, Eric Kendricks, kind of some of those things. I was alluding to that before the technology went funky on us, but I think they're going to be in a better spot to go do some of the things that they want to do. What that means for Cousins, I think, is going to be the big question, and we'll have a better idea of that, I would expect, next week once his agent gets down there and starts to meet with teams and talk a little more about where he's at in his rehab and, you know, all of the talk about guaranteed money, fully guaranteed contracts, all these kinds of things that have been floating around this week. I think that gets a little easier to see how much people are going to kind of stand on principle there once the market clears itself up. It's one thing to say, nope, we're going to die on this hill, whether you're Cousins or whether you're the Vikings at this point. It's a different thing when it's, okay, if we are going to die on this hill, it is going to mean that either he's with a new team or they're without him. And how much do people want to kind of stick to their guns at that point, I think, is a bigger indicator, certainly, than what we might be able to do at the moment.
Noonish today, Guardsy and I taped Enough Said, the TV show we do on Friday nights. It'll be on at on the Plus at 7:30 tonight, and on Fox 9 at 9:30. Unfortunately, we're going up against both the, at that point, the Wild and the Timberwolves. But he had seen a report that I had not noticed from somewhere that I wanted to run by you, suggesting that the sweet spot on a Cousins deal to keep him here might well be 2 years, $70 million, with $50 million of it guaranteed. And my reaction off the top of my head was, that would be, I think, something the Vikings would have to go for, that would be friendlier than I thought it would be. It's not all guaranteed, in fact, and it's not per year as much as I thought it might get to. So are you aware of that report? Do you buy it? Do you think that is the sweet spot? Or is there any reason to believe that that's a number that would get Cousins people's attention and put an end to this nonsense before free agency even begins?
Yeah, I haven't seen the extent of it today. I haven't been monitoring the rumor mill probably to the extent that I should be, as I'm trying to catch a little downtime before the deadline. But if they were able to get that done, I mean, certainly the Vikings would have interest in that. I think that would be a structure and a contract that they would say, yeah, we can work with this. I think the big question I continue to have is how much, and we talk about standing on principle here. I mean, Cousins has had a certain type of contract he's wanted to do in the past, and I think his comments about structure at the end of the season alluded to this too, where it's, I want guaranteed money. I want to have short-term certainty over, you know, 6 or 7 year deals. I mean, certainly that's not in the question at this point, but even when he was younger, he was not looking for 6 or 7 year deals. It was a lot of short contracts with more guarantees. And certainly that's what he was looking for last year. And we've talked about it, that's kind of where things broke down. If then the question for him becomes, do I want it to look the way it has in the past, or do I say, you know what, I like Kevin O'Connell, I like what I have here, I like Justin Jefferson, I've made enough money, and this can work. I think, important to note, he's had fully guaranteed deals in the past. He's had deals that have basically become practically guaranteed because he's been on the roster and all of these things, but not every deal he has signed in Minnesota has been 100% guaranteed at the start. I mean, that was really the thing that stuck out with that first deal in 2018, but he's had some where it hasn't been quite all fully guaranteed. So I think there is some room to negotiate and some room to work with some of those things in there. If he were, I think that would certainly be something the Vikings would
have a
pretty strong indicator to do.
I would think so. And I'm not as big a Kirk Obo as some people, but I'd say, unless the plan B that's available is really attractive and I don't know about it, I'd have to strongly consider exactly, I think, that kind of move for sure. Somebody has texted, though, regarding the salary cap situation. Can you also look at it as, well, that's $30 million for every other team, too, and that might make it easier for other teams to say, guess what? We're going to blow them out of the water a little bit. We got an extra, $10 to $15 million we can apply to whatever we were already prepared to give Kirk Cousins because we're desperate enough and we think we're willing to take that kind of a risk. It might create more flexibility for those teams, correct?
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, if there's more money to be spent, it certainly helps players a lot. And the other thing we should remember in the NFL, it resets every 4 years, basically, but you have to spend a certain amount of your salary cap space every 4 years. So if you are a team that has not spent to a certain threshold, I believe it's typically around 90%, in year four, you are now the team that has to go just throw a bunch of money around almost willy-nilly to get to that floor. So there are some of these teams, I think, that can drive prices up if you're in that spot. I think this is going to come down to a lot of some of the things that he talked about, where I think he said, I've made more money than I ever expected I would. He's probably made more than he'll spend. He's not a guy that is, owning houses in Malibu and Vail and all of those types of things. So how important is it to him to stay here and to finish his career in Minnesota? I think all of those questions, there's going to be a dollar amount attached to that at some point of how much he desires to do that. And it's going to be fascinating, I think, to watch because, there's no doubt Kirk Cousins has been in the contract negotiation or NFL Business Hall of Fame for a long time. And he's done a very good job leveraging his stance and his contributions to the league to make a lot of money. Is it going to be the same principle or is it going to change a little bit where he says, hey, I'm almost 36. I want to stay here and let's work to make that happen, even if it means some of the money I could make elsewhere is kind of gone by the wayside, at least for now.
Ben Goessling brought to you by Standard Heating and Air Conditioning. One of the other hot rumors that developed, I believe, last weekend when I was out of town, suggested, again, I'll leave it to you to determine how credible some of this stuff is, that there may be a hesitation on the part of the Vikings. I don't know if this is an ownership, at least what the suggestion was, that this was an ownership hesitation or even front office hesitation, to give major guaranteed money to Justin Jefferson, and that might end up being a sticking point here and maybe even part of the reason that the deal hasn't already gotten done. What do you hear about that? What do you think about that? Those suggestions?
Yeah, I saw that, and I think that's been tossed around a little bit. I want to say that was maybe a Mike Florio thing that
he was
bringing
yes.
that up. And that historically has been something that they have wanted to do, where it's the full guarantees come in the first year of the deal, and then they will kind of do these rolling guarantees where it's guaranteed for injury at first, and then it becomes fully guaranteed later. I would be surprised if that is the sticking point with Jefferson, because I got the sense, even with some of the deals they were talking about last year, and not just with Jefferson, that there was a willingness to say, we can come off of that philosophy at least a little bit for a certain type of player. And I think Jefferson is that type of player, obviously. I mean, they want to get this done. They want him here. I don't know at this point if that is the sticking point. I mean, my sense is that he does want to know how the quarterback situation is going to look. I just don't think at this point there's a ton of cause for alarm. If it gets into okay, he's not signed at training camp, or we get to the start of the season again and it's not done, then I think you say, okay, what's going on here? Why is this not getting to completion? But I think at this point for him, it makes all the sense in the world to say, I want to know who is throwing me the ball before I sign
yes.
away the rest of my prime with this team. So I would look at the timeline for this as something that probably happens later in the spring once the quarterback situation is a little clearer. I don't think that the financial piece of it will be impossible to I don't think there's a gap that's so big to bridge. I think there was a little bit of language stuff or a little bit of structure stuff that didn't get it done last year, at least from what I've heard. But I think when you're a year closer to free agency, it probably is a little different story. Some of that last year was he had 2 years left on his original deal. I think when you get to the point where it's a year before free agency, and yes, they could do the franchise tag, all that stuff, but when you get closer to this point, I think the discussions change a little bit, and I don't think that there's any great cause for alarm on that front at this point.
The decision to push the date on the Davenport deal back means what? Does that mean you think that they are trying there's a financial advantage of doing that down the road, or that this means they really are going to try to find a way to keep him after the disaster that was last season?
Well, I mean, they tried it. They tried this last year with Dalvin Tomlinson and tried to get something done to keep Dalvin Tomlinson. Ultimately, obviously, did not happen. Davenport, to me, is a little more of a head-scratcher because it did not go well. And I don't think I put it this way. I did not come out of last season thinking this is a guy that there's great interest, great energy toward bringing back. So it does give them probably a little bit more time to see if they can come up with something that he's got a couple of void years in there. So
right.
You could push a little bit of that money down the road. If you could get something affordable and maybe it allows them to have time for him to see what his market looks like. And if he says, you know what, there's not a great offer here, I can come back and be in Minnesota again. Maybe that's part of it there, but yeah, that one to me, I have not thought that there's going to be like this big push to bring him back or this big momentum to bring him back based on how last season went. Now, Danielle Hunter is about to hit free agency too, and they are not in a good spot in terms of pass rushers. So there's that piece of it. But yeah, that one is a little bit of a head scratcher to me in terms of thinking that there's going to be this big push to bring him back for another year.
In my mind, if I'm ranking the so-called big three of Cousins, JJ, and Daniil, my sense of it is that Daniil coming back is the greatest long shot. I just have this feeling that for Daniil, this is my time, this is my opportunity, and I'm going to go where, obviously, I assume he's going to try to go to a team that's viable, that's relevant. But chances are there's a relevant team that will pony up the money and be willing to pay big, big bucks to get him, that it's least likely that he comes back. Am I making that up, or what's your own view on that?
No, that's how I would rank it as well. I mean, I think the desire to get a big contract and to get probably something that he feels would reflect his production is going to be high for him. I mean, he's going to be 29, or he'll be 30, I guess, in October. Hard to believe for as long as he's been around and as long as he's kind of been one of the younger guys. I mean, this is kind of his last big shot at the open market, and he's coming off of perhaps the best season of his career. So, yes, I think he looks at this after playing a lot of years on a deal that he signed early, I think probably didn't work in his favor as much in terms of the type of money he could have made if he'd waited a little bit longer to sign. Certainly was a very team-friendly deal at the time. But I think the number of years where he has either played on that deal or restructured it without any real advances in cash or advances in the overall term of the deal, I think that has built up to the point where he is going to say, yeah, I want to go out and take my swing and make some serious money here in kind of my last shot at free agency. I think he certainly will look at places where he had the chance to win. I think that's going to be a big part of it. But that one feels like there's not this sort of hometown advantage or Vikings advantage just based on the years here. I would be surprised if that wins the day with him as much as it possibly could with Cousins.
James wants to know if you were running in shorts and a tank top yesterday. He apparently thinks he spotted you. Was that you?
No, it was not. Oh. I was running yesterday, but not in shorts and a tank top. I've had shorts on a few times this week, but I didn't go quite that aggressive with it.
Maybe
yesterday.
Next Monday, though. Monday is supposed to hit 60.
Possible.
So who knows? By then, you might well be in the mood for it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the phrase "suns out, guns out" is not something you typically say in February. No. But in the El Nino winter, I mean, why not?
Maybe we'll.
You can
well,
do it, why not?
That's exactly it. All right. Well, thanks for the Gopher report from the barn, and thanks for Vikings update as well. We'll chat next week.
Sounds good. I will be at the Combine next week, so we can chat on location from Indianapolis.
That's right. It's coming up. Unbelievable. Yeah, well, you'll hear from us for sure. Thank you.
All right. Sounds good. Thanks, Dan.
Ben Goessling, brought to you by Standard Heating and Air Conditioning. We've got Lavelle, another Friday regular at 5:30. Ben got moved up from his regular 4:30 time because we've got Sam Mitchell, who is in town doing some Timberwolves duty today on behalf of the organization, along with another old-timer by the name of Jerome Pooh Richardson, the first draft choice in Minnesota Timberwolves history. So we'll see what Sam has to say about the Timberwolves as they start the second half tonight against the Bucks right here on the Timberwolves channel via the iHeart Radio app. Wild on the Fan, beginning with, you said, an extended pregame show at 7:00.